1967, the Afro-American Society was established. In 1968, a body of very passionate students came together and were concerned about several issues. They were concerned about the survival of black students. And you have to remember that was an era where minority was used synonymously with black,
right.
Negro, Native American. And during that 68 walkout, it is my understanding that it was 8 female women who were very concerned about the quality of life of African-American students on campus. They were very passionate and very well documented. If you go to the Rock or the John Hay Library, more importantly, and do some research, you will see that they were extremely well documented. And that's the Dig It era. The Dig It era. That was an era where there was slang was emerging in a big way. And it was also very interesting to see how people were so passionate about their goals that they went so far as to put their careers on the line. Clearly, they didn't call home and say, look, I'm tired of what's going on this campus, and I'm going to walk off. But those 8 women were instrumental in leading others off campus. And they went to the Congdon Street Baptist Church, where they sought shelter. The issues were the need to increase the number of minority students, increasing financial aid. There was also concern about the survival of black students once they got here. So the transitional summer program, predecessor to Third World Transition Program, was created. And there is a documentation that African-American enrollment increased 300%. Asian American Students Association, I can recall because I was here from 70 to 73. Those Asian American students who were here did in fact want to build coalitions with black students and vice versa. But I think it's also worth noting that the early members were associated, as I understand it, with the Communist Party. I don't think anything's been written on this. So I could be spreading another rumor, a rumor, but the reality is that there were a substantial number of documents that were destroyed years later, before the membership left campus. So I'd say between 69 and 73. The records were all destroyed. By 72, the Latin American Students Association was founded. And there was at least a captive audience, whatever numbers, though low they were, a captive audience of Latino students who were interested in building coalitions. I think it's also worth noting that in 72, 360 Black Experience was founded. And that was founded by Vincent Thomas and Harold Bailey. And they began to have a Sunday program that exists today that was most meaningful, not just for the brown community of color, but also the Providence community.
I'm gonna get you to the song. Here we go. Enchantment with Where Do We Go From Here. Keep it locked. 95.5 WBRU Providence.
Then rolls 1973, when there was a body of students who, in the past, black students in the past, served as big brothers and big sisters from I'd say 70 to about 73. So by 73, there was, and they volunteered to serve as tutors, mentors to black students who came on campus. But by 73, the program went from Big Brother, Big Sister to the Minority Peer Counselor program. Takeover. That was a time where Third World Coalition was strong and began. The second aspect of the experience was that the students were then too very well written, and they documented everything, comparing what had happened in 68 and what was not complied with. And I believe that the students also wanted a third world center. They wanted a place where students of all ethnic backgrounds could convene and have some space to meet and have receptions and so on. And for 75, the students decided we're going to take over University Hall. You might say, what does that mean, takeover? Did they run through the halls and tell people who were in their offices to get out? No. But they did occupy the space. They were in the windows of University Hall. People were speaking on the college green. But they were smart. This body of students decided that they were going to look to the most articulate members of their class, to not do all the work. All the written work was done. They went to J.J. Jackson, who was in the class of 75, and they asked him, would he go to the negotiating table with the deans? And he said, yes, I'll be honored to do that. It was the energy and the impetus of students who wanted to make our society a better place. And I think they were very passionate about what they were doing. And not to compare their advocacy to the advocacy that exists today in 1998, but to note that the trailblazers were advocating for all the folks who are here today. They were unselfish. And I think that's something that's very special. Then in 1985, there was another third world student protest asking the university for a recommitment to the 68 demands along with the 75 demands. And also, this is the sign of the first documentation on ethnic studies or minorities in the undergraduate curriculum. And also in 85, the students wanted a third world center, no longer a basement. They were increasing in numbers and the space was not meeting the needs of all the constituencies. So in 1986, and they also requested, 85, they requested that a report be done on minority life on Brown University's campus.
The same spirit which characterized the 1975 Third World Movement, we proudly claim today, 10 years later. Appropriately, we have chosen this, the John Carter Brown Library, as the location for our action. This library, named after the family who made their fortune on the slave trade of African people alike,
make your point, Harold.
Our ancestors, and which possesses still the important books and artifacts documenting early American history, attest to the validity of our statement.
That's right.
We are here to stay, because we have always been here.
All right, all right. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right.
Our blood runs through this soil.
That's right.
The history of black people at Brown is not separate from the history of black people in the United States. Black people have had to struggle to fight and demand for all which we have justly deserved.
That's right.
This library bears record of us. We are asking the university for that same recognition.
Thank you.
am now going to read a statement asking exactly what we want. When people are invisible, they will do anything in their power to be seen. When people are quieted, they will do anything in their power to be heard. Without these two fundamental levels of respect, people are not people at all. They're simply objects. We, the black and third world students of Brown University, feel as if we are invisible and voiceless. We have met with university officials on numerous occasions in recent weeks, and although we have been listened to, we have not been heard.
All right.
Over the last hour or so, the university has agreed to concede to certain of our demands.
So in 86, a couple of things happened. We moved, the Third World Center moved from the basement of Churchill to the building we now occupy, which is Partridge Hall. And the Blue Ribbon Committee published their report. Blue Ribbon Committee was made up of alumni and distinguished educators from all ethnic groups. And they did a report. And they entitled it The American University and the Pluralist Ideal. And there's a dissenting opinion, which was written by Lerone Bennett, who is editor of Ebony Magazine. So in the spring of 86, we moved into the Third World Center, Partridge Hall, and also in 1987, the 100th Latino student graduated from Brown.
The struggle doesn't end here.
That's right.
The university has made certain allowances today, and we thank God for those allowances. But let it be known that our voices will not be silent from now on. The university has heard us, and let them now hear this. University, we are watching you.
All right.
We are watching everything that you do.
All right.
We will ensure that you uphold to your part of the bargain.
All right.
You will not be allowed to renege on your part of the bargain.
All right.
The struggle does not end here.
All right.
And I saw a woman come out of the bathroom, and she looked at me and she said, "What's up with the bathroom?" And I said, "What are you talking about?" And I walked down the hallway and opened the door. And Andrews, there's a common room with sinks, and then there's a door for the men and a door for the women. And the word men had been crossed out, as had the word women. And over the word woman, someone had written with a black magic marker, whites. And over men, it had been crossed out, and someone had written the word niggers.
In 1988-89, there was again another student uprising. There was a protest specifically asking for ethnic studies. And also a request for a recommitment to, now we have demands from 68, 75, and now 85. And it was a time where students were quite frustrated because there were also racial incidents being reported on our campus.
I walked into the women's room, and it was funny because we were actually joking about, I hope we don't have any more terror in the bathroom. And I closed the door behind me and turned around, and there was a flyer had been printed out on a Macintosh computer. And I can't remember exactly how it went, but it said something to the effect that Brown used to be a place where white men could go to class and not have to look at little brown faces, little black faces, and little yellow faces. The college has gone downhill since the kitchen help moved into the classroom. Keep white supremacy alive. Join the Brown chapter of the KKK.
And he said he'll go as far as to call on the FBI to catch those responsible for several recent racist acts at a campus dorm. There, someone painted racial slurs on bathroom doors and distributed a flyer promoting a Brown chapter of the Ku Klux Klan.
There's things in the elevator, specifically things like fuck homos, die homos, and it started off small with small writing, and I think people just decided to get a little more daring as time went by, and it got big and big until the letters were like 3 or 4 inches.
For a few days before, we've been hearing about there being graffiti in the elevators and on the doorways and some anti-gay graffiti and some anti-black graffiti. And people had, at the time, just thought they were, you know, by erasing it, that was the best way to get rid of it. So people had kind of erased it originally, and people were kind of nervous about it.
And I will not tolerate racism in this institution.
Give America race will exist.
The Brown administration was only expecting about 250 students to show up. They got over 1,000.
There are many outlets in this country for racism and bigotry. Brown will not be one of them, and I can assure you of that.
These are the same issues that come up time and time and time again, but each time a little bit more gets tipped off of this institutional racism that we're talking about.
He says there isn't a Klan chapter at the Ivy League school.
To my knowledge, there's no active chapter not registered with this office.
The students today issued a list of long-term demands. They include changes in the curriculum to reflect the issues and concerns of the third world and lesbian, gay, bisexual communities. They also want more support services and improved police sensitivity.
Maybe if you can talk about how, I mean, just looking at all these documents,
yes.
All the demands are the same.
Yeah, honey, yes, from 68, girl.
Oh, my God.
I've had people drive down Fair Street in cars, yell out to my friends and me while we're walking down, go back to Asia. I've had my friends called out, you know, by people in cars on Thayer Street saying, oh, you little brown face, aren't you good in bed? This is Brown.
Students were so appalled that their fellow students might be racist that what resulted was little faction groups coming out against racism as the cause of the semester. And the administration funded kind of a project of printing up little purple KKK stickers, fight the KKK stickers, which they passed out on the green, and so then everyone wore a sticker and said, you know, I'm not a racist, and it became kind of the popular thing.
I issued a 20-page document, so to say that I have not responded to 40-page list of demands and requests and so forth is most unfair.
We received 10 pages in his letter that really said very little upon scrutiny, and we received more paper later, which was basically more of the same. And what we were looking for were results. We were looking for change. Unfortunately, this semester that just passed, we saw very little of it.
So does anything ever change? I don't know. I don't think so. I think so many people have said that, you know, they were here coming in 85, you know, and they left and this started again. And why am I just so sure that when I graduate, this is going to happen again?
Lifestyle of America's brain trap. Nigga, this is West Side.
Nigga, this is East Side.
Oh, cuz.
Oh, this love.
It's on like this, and it's on like that. Cocks the Glock, cuz it don't stop. 6'4", dipping, 40 sipping, set tripping. Hitting that Sherm, trying to catch a nigga slipping. A full-time job, but you don't understand. A confused boy, trying to be a man. Never knew pops and moms couldn't swing it. Gaining respect the best way he can get it. A little ass chick need to slow his roll, cause he didn't even know that the world was a ghetto.
The next thing, TNT was founded.
Deedle-dum-dum, there was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert, and danger threatened him, he never got hurt, he knew just what to do.
The next thing is a confidential support group for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender questioning students of color at Brown and RISD universities.
Also in 91, there was a population of students who were on financial aid who wanted the university to apply need-blind admissions. And it was interesting because this was the first time they initiated a takeover of University Hall. And I know that it was said that President Gregorian was not on campus. However, that was the first time for a protest or a takeover, not even a protest, for a takeover, that the university felt it was important to arrest those students. And there was, the green was filled with students. And there was a population of those students who went into the building and occupied, to my knowledge, the corporation room. And I believe the charges were subsequently dropped.
The Latinos are here march. That was basically a walkout. That was led by Claudia Crespo and Dunia Fernandez back in 1993, was basically a march done by only these two people. It was publicized, it was organized, it was decided upon only by two individuals. And that upsets me because there's 300 and, let's say, about 300 to 400 Latinos on campus, and only two of those 300 to 400 people, Latinos, had the consciousness or the drive to pull this march through. And after, you know, after constant struggle and them being demeaned through their grades and them just being burned out because they were so active, I mean, there was just no support for them. And that alienates other people, or it doesn't encourage more political activism. And I have a real, real big problem with that, because I feel that my presence here on campus is a political statement. Mm-hmm. And I feel that by people not feeling that same sense, that is just, we're falling through into the same game that the white man wants to play on us.
I was in a unit in the quad, and I think it was about 12 African-American women and one man were walking out of Josiah's, and buckets of cold water were poured at them. And, you know, they all came to my door, and we called police and security. And their response was, you know, this really is an emergency. But I realized in the wake of everything that was going around, this really, even if no slurs were yelled, this possibly could have been racially motivated. So called Ravi, called Andrea, I was on MPC exec board, so we definitely put a lot of pressure on police and security and the student life office to realize, you know, what was happening on campus. But it also started with a South Asian student being beaten by a white student that didn't go to Brown. And I was actually really disappointed that the other communities of color didn't see how this affected them. And it had to happen to these women to have water poured on them, or to have niggers who all on someone's door for people to realize that it was affecting us all as a community of color. So I feel if it affects one of us, it affects all of us.
Things were quiet between actually 90 and 94. But around 94, there were racial incidents being reported, not isolated incidents, incidents in numbers. Were reported by African Americans and South Asians, and there were a few harassments of Southeast Asians. And then I can recall the minority peer counselors at that time had said, "Dean McClellan, we have to do something."
The emergency mechanism of the university to handle crises like this wasn't working in the way it really should.
I was very surprised. Secondly, I was very scared. And especially because it happened to one of my very best friends here on campus. And she was very scared. And the fact that she felt as though she could walk around campus without someone else next to her wasn't a comforting feeling to me. And it sort of disillusioned me about the idea of Brown and living in a safe environment and being able to feel safe in your environment at your school. And for a time, she felt as though this wasn't her school and this wasn't her safe environment because of what had happened to her. After I saw how the community sort of bonded together and worked together, it was very inspiring, and it was very, I guess, fulfilling in a way, being at the rally that was held out in the green and seeing how everybody from all ethnic backgrounds, from race backgrounds, from class backgrounds, everybody sort of bonding together in this sort of common experience and common need to do something for one another was very inspiring, like I said before, and it gave me hope for our community here at Brown and the fact that we can work together. I only hope that as a result of this, we don't only work together in emergency situations, but we know that we can work together, and it's almost better to work together at all times so that in emergency situations, we can be there immediately.
Students at Brown had a strong history of activism. The students at Brown realized that they weren't coming here as singular individuals, but they were coming representing their entire races and just coming with a legacy of activism from their homes, but also with a legacy, coming into a legacy of activism. And I think that's something that's very important for any third world student here. You're not alone. You're not alone with other students of color here on campus, but you're also not alone with the history that's here. When you come, you're coming into at least 30 years of strong activism, strong support from people of color. And when you get here, there is an expectation that you carry it on. Not that you have to carry it on with, you know, marching and carrying pickets, but that you know, and that when the time comes, you come together and offer your support in any way possible. Racism, sadly enough, is not dead. But we're also not going to lie down and let it beat us.
We want freedom. We want power to determine the destiny of our own black communities. We want decent education that teaches us about the true nature of this racist, decadent system. Education that teaches us about our true history and our role in society and the world today. We want education, we want justice, and we want freedom.
Studies began first with the Asian American Students Association and their movement to bring not only Asian American studies onto campus, but a faculty support as well as administrative support. And that movement blossomed in the spring of that year, 1996. And interestingly enough, it bloomed with the Latino convocation in March. And at the time, actually, there was a national movement for ethnic studies, which I think is very important to note that there was a national context for ethnic studies. So there was momentum building up, mainly on the East Coast, to push for ethnic studies. And the hunger strike at Columbia was one of the major points from which we were able to get inspiration. And following the convocation, we had a candlelight vigil outside on Fonts, commemorating or showing our mutual support for ethnic studies at Columbia. And I think that was the first place where we realized how much student support was actually available or around on campus, not only among the Asian American student community, but in the Latino community. And I would say that that was the first point where the Latino students and Asian American students began to think in terms of coalition, in terms of working together on this issue. And from that point, there was meetings with the heads of both organizations to try to plan ethnic studies meetings. And at one point, at the height of the meetings, there was almost 90 people for our general body meeting, I believe, which is by far the largest gathering of students of color and white students working on politics that I've ever seen at Brown. And from that point, we organized teach-in to keep people informed on the development of ethnic studies on campus, which at the time was nil, as well as to inform students how long the struggle for ethnic studies had been happening at Brown. We were not, our demands from even 10 years ago were not being addressed by the administration. And one of our demands was that we be involved, students be directly involved in development of the ethnic studies proposal. So how that happened was we had two student interns funded out of the Center for Race and Ethnic Studies working with Feinitz that summer.
I don't see many coalitions. Like, I think ethnic studies was like the climax of coalitions, and that was basically between Asian Americans and Latino students, because I didn't really see any other ethnicity being represented except for Tony Pitts, which is black, and that's it. So I mean, that's really sad. I mean, that's only one person that I can think of.
Something I might add about that time was that there were a number of students who still were very active with ethnic studies, and we tried to put together a number of general body meetings again. And the first meeting during that fall was a pretty good turnout. We also hosted a panel with Sainice Miller and the two interns to talk about the proposal right before it was handed in. And in fact, we didn't have much input because she allowed us to look at it maybe a day before it had to be turned in. so nothing was changed as a result of all the students gathering together. It was a very angry meeting because a lot of the students were very committed to those, the same demands that we had that earlier spring. But nothing would have been changed in that proposal. Nothing was going to be changed in that proposal, and we felt very excluded from that process, even though we're the ones who brought it about in the first place. It was taken out from our hands and given to the hands of the administration, who did not include our demands, did not include our interests or our perspectives. So when that proposal was approved, a lot of the people who were involved with it were so burnt out, first of all. But second of all, a lot of people on campus who, you know, started thinking about ethnic studies thought that the fight was over because they saw this big spread in the BDH, the big spread in the Independent, a big spread in the Georgia State Journal about how Brown is great and it has this ethnic studies program and how progressive the administration is. So people sort of dropped like flies from the ethnic studies struggle, even though we had not achieved nothing except for a name.
We do have an ethnic studies program at Brown, and we can only build upon it. And there's another piece of the history in terms of academia that is worth noting, and that's Afro-EM. Afro-EM started in the late 60s, 69, and next year they will have been a program for 30 years. And I'm sure that the resist team will also be answerable and concerned about that movement from program to a department.
Always are talking, it's always at their disposal and they decide. And I think we're, I mean, the same thing with environmental justice, you know, this whole issue of all of a sudden these great, wonderful corporations that are, you know, so-called national environmental organizations want people of color to join their boards. They want people of color to whatever, whatever. And it's always about them needing us because we are their stamp of approval for everyone else in a, you know, highly racialized society. Finally, they know we're here. So, like, now they need us to, you know, finally they need us to sort of, like, stamp it and be like, okay, look, we're progressive. We are environmentally aware and we are environmentally blah, whatever, whatever. Mm-hmm. It's a bunch of bullshit and it comes down to you being always a token.
Questions for you. I wanted to know how you plan on incorporating women and particularly women of color into decision-making processes with policies.
Well, I think it's important that we have a very open process at this university in terms of decision making. It is not done in the president's office. It's not done behind closed doors. It's not done with preconceived agendas. And so, therefore, if you're going to have an open decision making process, then you have to have people who are involved in the decision being part of that process. That means that women, that means that men, that means that those who have differing views, and certainly in this instance you asked about women of color, that they have an opportunity to be part of the discussions and also to be involved in leadership to allow those decisions to be made. And that's what will happen.
Will you have a structure in place where you'll have like open meetings for?
Yeah, I've always have done that, even at a very large university. I've always had been very open about moving around the campus and having open forums and opportunities to come. I sleep overnight in residence halls in order to be able to get to know the students better. I have various kinds of options available for students to come and visit with me, and obviously for faculty and staff. So I'll continue that here.
Okay, and also a lot of women of color are also concerned about your stance on ethnic studies, and how you plan on supporting or not supporting the small and unfunded ethnic studies program here at Brown.
Well, I don't know enough about the program yet, frankly. We have an ethnic studies program at Ohio State, which I've been involved with and supportive of. I just simply will have to be given an opportunity to study where we are and what our plans are. I certainly have no objections to an ethnic studies program, but to ask me a question as to what my stance is about something I don't know would be unfair for me to give an answer.
Would you be willing to hold a forum in which students and faculty are involved with talking about ethnic studies and their concerns?
Absolutely. That would be something that I would welcome, as a matter of fact. because once I'm here, it's going to become my university, and it's going to become my administration. And so the opportunity in the immediate time that I have to find out more about what the institutional priorities are and what the institutional issues are and what areas need to be supported and what areas need to be eliminated, that's exactly what I'm going to do.
VA. Yeah. New York. Uh-huh. Atlanta. Uh-huh. D.C. Uh-huh. L.A. Uh-huh. New Jersey. Uh-huh. Philly. Uh-huh. Say what? Uh-huh.
Whenever I have to think about things, it just always, most of the time, it comes back. It mostly comes back to the, like, gender-race intersection, even though right when I think about gender, I can't help but think about sexual orientation and whatever. It's really hard to make judgments, but I just, you know, a lot of the times when I'm dealing with Elmo, he doesn't question, like, race as a primary source of, you know, oppression or whatever, because, like, I mean, we're dealing with that big dick, you know, and it comes in every color, and, you know, we're all holding it, you know, I'm just putting it in really blunt terms, you know.
I think there's a big need to support one another, regardless if you have kinky hair, slanted eyes, tan skin, it doesn't matter. I think we're all human beings first, and our ethnicity and language and everything else is secondary to that. And we need to support one another because we need to see ourselves as separate teams that are fighting against the same dominator. We're playing this game in which they've already told us, you're going to lose, but try to win. But you're still going to lose, but go ahead.
Waste your energy.
Waste your energy, because I'm gaining from your wasting your energy. So here, I invite you to play a game, and I'm sorry you're going to lose, but I've created the system so that you will lose and I will win. So I would just want people to realize this realize what I've just said and take some action on that and understand that it's a we against them, not an I against them. It's a we. There's many of us, and they're using us as pawns against one another so that we can never congregate together and build this force against them. I mean, they're really smart. I'm saying they're real smart, and we just need to be smarter than them.
We don't, as a community or a group, a collective, whatever federal folk on this campus are right now, want to acknowledge our role in how we hurt and oppress each other and ourselves. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I think that I can't decide. Maybe I'd like to throw this question out, you know, whatever, even if it's just something for people to think about. I wonder if people are more willing to recognize, acknowledge how they oppress themselves or how they oppress other people of color. You know, because, like, I know that a lot of things that have been going on in my mind lately have been in conversations with, like, my friends, or my intimates, I should say, talking about, like, self-perception, you know, as women, and how much more we tend, for instance, to give to men, like to men of color, and in terms of allies, you know, like, oh yeah, I was talking to some so-and-so dick.
You never know a good thing till I'm gone. Uh-huh. You'll be spending many, many nights home alone. You won't be seeing me around your way, no, no. And if you don't get it together, baby, I can't stay.
I don't know, like, getting ready to leave Brown, it's pretty depressing to me, but, like, I'm starting to question if, like, I did or do or have any sort of place here at all. And I just, like, upon leaving here, I feel so defeated as far as, like, issues concerning Native Americans go. I mean, so absolutely defeated. Like, we don't even exist as far as the BDH concerns. If you added up the percentages of, like, white students, black students, Asian students, Latino students, it adds up to 100%. you know, and 9 Native Americans were accepted for the next year. And I don't know, just with everything, I'm just really, really tired. And I just kind of feel like it's almost a waste of time for me to do that. I mean, I feel like, honestly, at Brown, I'm a person of color and not Native American. And in, like, the real world, I'm Native American. But I feel like any time I sit down to some discussion, and I went to this town meeting or whatever on race, sponsored by the whatever that stupid office is, Dean Rose. anyway.
No.
I was in it?
Huh?
Dean what?
It was Dean Rose, one of the things that
Office
she
of Student Strife.
But I totally, like, I didn't even mention, really, other than to, like, ethnically identify myself, I didn't mention the entire time being Native American, because looking around that room, like, these people weren't going to get it. Like, they weren't going to get it at all. You know, I couldn't even begin to talk about, like, issues facing Native Americans. And I feel like that a lot at Brown. Like, obviously, you know, the struggles of all people of color are important to me, but I feel like I really do make a choice a lot, just because, and not because anyone forces me to, but just because no one's going to understand. And if I'm going to accomplish anything, I might as well, like, shoot for something that might, in some remote sense, be possible, which is not issues facing Native Americans.
Like, even once you, like, gain a consciousness of how you were socialized to hurt yourself and to hurt others, it's very difficult to every single day actively unravel that socialization. And I have to say that it's become internal to me, that process. Like, I know it's going to take me the rest of my life and then some, and a little bit more, to just unravel that all that damage that's been done to me and my sisters. And that's one of those, like, few unlofty lifetime goals, is to, like, deconstruct it and just get rid of it.
I feel
kill
like
it.
Too many of us aren't willing to go there, though.
That's where, like, alliances and, like, communities like this play a part, because I think one of the biggest parts of, like, one of the biggest growth experiences that I've had is learning who your allies are and hanging on to them as tight as you can, and doing for them, doing for them what you would want to be done to for yourself, and just your all. And, like, well, classic example is my girl and others who've helped nurture that, and to tell, constantly remind me that you're not. It is not all you, you know, it's not all you that has to go through whatever shit you have to go through. It's not all you. It's like, there are, I'll be damned if this is not, like, if your life is not a community effort on its own. And Jocelyn and I constantly talk about family, future family, and how they'll operate as far as, like, her and I are concerned, or as far as, like, our close intimate circle is concerned. Like, if we were to ever have, like, children in our lives, or whatever, family, that we would be damned if they would be raised, like, without each other, like, without a village, without people to help you out on that, to know that you don't gotta raise your kids by your family, you don't gotta raise yourself by yourself, you gotta raise a community by yourself, that there are women, I'll just say women, damn it, there's just women out there, because it's safer to assume that the women will be there for you most of the time, and that it's definitely crucial, and it really saddens me, because these kinds of things only happen in sporadic, like, in just, like, when there's somebody's doing a project on it, or, like, somebody wants to host a tea, or somebody wants to do a dramatic presentation about gender, and, like, it saddens me that comes on very superficial lines, you know, and, like, yeah.
Because every movement lasts longer than the 1 year or 2 years that you know, you as one person might be involved in campus politics. If you look at ethnic studies, it's been around for over 10 years now, and we keep repeating ourselves. And I think it's important that as leaders, you build continuity within any movement, always sharing information about the past, but also giving other students the opportunity to lead for the future.
Want is respect, right? Yo, this one up on the track, I also have to deal with it, right? Freedom every time for the sisters. Check this. Watch this.
Now here we go now. Listen, if I'm poopoo rule, I be the ruler like Slick Rick.
Well, my news is that I'm really an alien and I'm pregnant right now. And I just find out because the man told me so.
What are you going to do about it?
Well, I'm going to have lots of alien babies and create a dystopian society.
Actually, I think it's happening, right?
The university has heard us, and let them now hear this. University, we are watching you.
All right!
We are watching everything that you do.
Right?
We will ensure that you uphold to your part of the bargain.
Right.
You will not be allowed to renege on your part of the bargain.
All right.
The struggle does not end here.
Don't let them steer you wrong. Hold on, because this has got it going on here. Spring your mind on
you. Fight the power now. I don't know, man. It's just tough, you know? It's like... It's tough.
Come and take a walk with me. Closer walk with these.
He's the... He's the dude. And we're all dudes, yeah!
Very good.
Power to the people. Power to the people.
Peace. And praise the Lord God. Coming to the light, let it shine. Blackness is fire, the blackness of the skin, the blackness of the mind.
I am who I am, and that's who I be. And I don't give a damn if your eyes can't see.
Forever. Shall build
and I shall
a house
build a people
that will stand.
And I shall
forever.
Build a people
shall build a house that will stand forever. Audre Lorde.